Besides Paul.
Just Paul and this one, and he's from Temple, they, okay. Then they put him down here.
So how am I going to get in? I need to know.
Ollie will be.
Can you get into?
I need to go visit. See, Paul wants me to come visit him, but he has. But I don't think.
So he needs to put you on the list.
Yeah, but the problem is that I want to go with a camera.
I will put you on the list. I will make some contacts, and I just try to get you in with a camera.
The camera?
I'm the camera guy because I want to meet them too. They, see how
they're going to be the camera guy.
You yes. need to I, get a permission.
They have contacts.
There's a form. There's a form you can fill out. I'll get you the information. I'll give it to you. The attorney.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Now, do you know anything about his, he had a, first of
do
all,
do you need proof of vaccination?
Do you think that he's a,
no.
Do you think that he got a good deal or a bad deal?
Was he the one who got the lawyer away?
Okay, let me tell you what happened. He okay, this lawyer, Patrick LeDuc, you ever heard of him?
No, he's a Tampa guy, right?
So he was in the reserves, old guy, really old guy. He is a lawyer, but he's also in the reserves.
Right.
And he also is very, very religious. So what he does when you come in, let's say you're the client.
Right.
The first thing he does is he says, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? So he converts them instantly. That's what he's very into that. So what he did with Paul was he got Paul to go to church and blah, 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 all that. So then he says, you have to do, God wants you to make right. You go right to the judge, tell him you did everything and you're, and just face the music, period. So he did that, but then he felt like, this is one of these
right,
things.
Right, right.
I actually call Paul my friend. We write every other day. I consider him of all of them. I'm torn between, so after the lawyer went away to the reserve to go serve in Afghanistan,
right.
He went and got another lawyer and said, wait a second, I feel like I was duped by my lawyer.
But then he got this new one.
He got a new lawyer who I have not talked to because I'm not sure I trust the new lawyer. Because first of all, he gets out May 18th. Is the lawyer going to be able to get him out before then? It's already January, February.
You're already with a conviction.
Yeah, but you could appeal it. Then it becomes like you're not a convicted felon. You still have status to appeal.
You can win an appeal.
If you win the appeal and overturn it. So he could still have some incentive. Yeah, like to.
So some days, I tell him he got great legal. Sometimes I say 8 months was great. Considering that the shaman who did not, what did the shaman do? He stood there. Right. What did Paul do? He stood there. The shaman got how many months? 41.
Yeah.
Compared to 8. So when I saw that, I was like, and I think that the government is going to go for more, that they're going to look to get bigger. Like people are criticizing some of the people that got home convicted. A lot of people have been getting probation and stuff. So I think they're looking to make people. Like, I think if Paul went now, he'd get a longer sentence.
What did he do? What did he do? He went.
He just walked in with the Trump flag into the Senate.
That's it.
And he got. So I don't know if 8 months was good or bad.
Well, for the charge itself, I'm looking from a charging point.
He didn't get to 15-12.
See, but you didn't walk into the Senate. See, walking into the Senate.
But I didn't do that.
I know, that's what I'm saying. That's the bad thing.
I wasn't even there to say it. A lot of these people are like, we're here to overturn these. I wasn't even there for that reason. I'm not there to overturn anything.
I think they might have used him to shore up their 15-12 charge, too. Because if they have people pleading to it, they're telling the judges, look, we already have people who pled to this felony. So if you overturn it for one case, you're going to overturn all the prior convictions. It puts more pressure on these district judges not to overturn it. Because, we have Paul, he's going to plead guilty to the 15-12. Because they dropped everything but the 15-12, the charge they never used before. So they're like, this guy will take 8 months, and we'll have another plea. They make every single person charged with the 15-12 plead to the 15-12. I haven't seen them drop it.
Mm. I'm very interested on the first trial, how that's going to look like.
Well, I think the one thing, if you drag it out, after the Democrats lose the House, and then they get rid of the committee, people may lose interest.
Yeah.
The first trials are going to get a lot of attention.
Yes.
It's like anniversaries. After the first one is a big deal. They made a really big deal. January 6th. Right. No one's going to care after the Democrats are out of power.
Right.
And then take Biden out of office, then who cares? If you drag it out long enough, I wouldn't go first for a trial. Because D.C. is a lot of people who work for the government.
Right.
And it's a lot of... I don't think they're unsympathetic.
That's the jury.
That's the jury is going to be... We don't need the trial to be held there.
Well, if you got it moved, you totally get off.
I wish
they successfully move it.
No, they won't move it. Because I mean, think about it. They'll resist it. They'll say how I've heard in hearings.
The locus of
the they're going to say, how dare you say we're not fair? We're fair.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then it's very. The last time the government moved the trial was the Oklahoma City bomber. They agreed to move it to Colorado. So that's they stipulated. Even the Boston bomber case, which is now on appeal, the city of Boston, or the federal judge there was like, what do you mean we can't be fair?
And the motion gets decided by the judge.
Yes. But there might be more favorable up the line. You know, we go to the D.C. Circuit of Appeals, the Supreme Court. They might say, well, wait a second. You have politicians every night comparing it to Pearl Harbor, 9/11.
That was just
D.C. In D.C., they're under siege at the National Guard there for 7 months. If you live there, you're like, I am under siege. I see National Guardsmen around here. You know, my city was attacked. The local media every day. You can't have a fair trial.
Well, the reason, I think time is going to remember January 6th differently. Yeah. Right now, people are still in the heat of them. There's two things. Media needs stuff to fill. I mean, if you watch TV on January 6th, it was like January 6th, 24/7. As time goes on, it's going to be less.
Yeah.
And so I think also people are going to lose their office, the jobs. The people that were there are going to lose their jobs. So it's not going to mean anything if you weren't even there and you don't even care.
We need like a war to break up.
Okay, I thank you for your time.
Oh, absolutely.
Listen, I really, I know you're not the bad guy. I mean, I haven't found the bad guy yet. But if there is, I know you're not the bad
guy. What is the guy with the eye patch? I mean, he's like a stereotypical bad guy.
But the thing is, why I asked you the question of like, so what was the plan? Is that if there was an insurrection, you were supposed to be in line, marching. You're in the military, you know
right.
this.
No, that's
you were supposed to have a plan.
It's called the operations order. You sit down like, overnight with your soldiers. You go over. All right, you're gonna go here. You're gonna go in by this side. At this time, we're gonna take over this. There's none of that.
If there was an insurrection, it's the sorriest insurrection in the 21st century ever. No guns.
A guy smoking pot.
Well, we did that. We just went to New Hampshire last week for the guy that just was drinking beer.
My favorite guy holding the pew, just waving.
Yeah. Oh, he's Florida. He's your Florida guy. Wait, what's gonna happen to him, Mr. Webb?
He got.
I'm waiting for sentencing, right?
Yeah,
but what's he gonna get?
Probably get a few months. I'm not sure if he got.
But he was standing next to the shaman in the Senate. So is the plea?
The guys with the electors?
Yes.
Yeah, he did more. So that's what pisses me off. These people are getting like, missed like 15 days. There was a guy that they said threw a fire extinguisher at the cops. They gave him 15 days.
That's why we told the prosecutor and the judge that he'll plea right now. We'll just go, you know, for
you're going to be able to laugh about this one day. If I were you, I would drag it out. That's what I would do. My strategy would be right now. Because
my leg's about to fall off.
If you can get that thing off.
Then
I would just wait.
Because
I wouldn't. The first trials, like this, I was in Ohio with this guy who is going to trial. He wants to subpoena Trump and make it like this whole like.
The district judge is not gonna.
I just want to subpoena the people who are involved with my case. For example, that officer that I gave water, the guy that interviewed me, probably or maybe one more person. But other than that, I want people.
Can you find him, Officer Lopez?
Yeah, let's find him.
You should find him. I mean, he's
if he has a name, you can find him.
Officer Lopez. We found some stuff on. He's from like Coachella.
California?
From the place where the concert's at?
Somebody told me, like, oh, he's a Coachella guy. And I was like, from the concert? Like, no, he's from the city. Local Coachella News did a thing about him because he got some award or something for being from the Capitol Police on that day. But he's the one in the video where he's offering him water. And he looks kind of shell-shocked.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to...
I'll look for him.
I've been in combat, so I know that feeling. His buddy's trying to talk to him, and he's like...
Yeah, he looks like he's out.
Yeah, he's out of it. Yeah.
So glad that I met you. Because the media makes you into a monster.
It does. And
I mean, when you watch it, you're like, let's look at clips, and it's all very like... And can I tell you a sad story? I'll let you go back to work because I know your time is
money.
So, in the summer, I went to lunch with. Do you know who Emily Hernandez is? Have you met her? Heard of her? Okay, the girl who her claim to fame was she took home and put on her wall the Nancy Pelosi Office of the Speaker sign.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So she was one of the people I wanted to get to really early because I was like, I know that, if I went to something like that and I took something home from my wall, I know that it's a memento and not a scalp.
Right, I knew she was
21 years old.
Right,
I knew this is not what they're making it seem.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I had lunch with her at her country club. And I was like, so what were you doing there? And she was like this.
Well, I'd never left Missouri before. I mean, like, my neighbor was driving to D.C. and I'd never been out of Missouri. And like, I was like, I'll go to D.C. because, like, I'd heard, like, the monuments. And I'm thinking, this girl is, like, barely finished high school. Like, farm girl.
Right.
Works
right.
on a farm. What do you do for a living? I work on my family's farm. And I was like,
Brand
and
one.
They're turning her into, like, public enemy number
yeah,
one.
I know.
And she's the most, like, almost you almost feel sad that she's so, luckily she had the lawyer, and her lawyer got it down. I mean, they walked in her bedroom and they saw the thing on the wall,
right?
So you think, oh, she's gonna go down. She got a misdemeanor, nothing, and would walk in, would get probation. But on the night of the anniversary of January 6th, she got drunk in a bar.
She got a DUI.
Killed a mother.
Oh, she
killed
him.
That's right.
Oh,
that's
her.
Mother.
She wrote against.
And it's clear.
For 6 months.
And now I'm telling you because I know her.
Yeah, yeah.
What happened was when the local news starts to. You're a guy who's been in the army.
Yeah.
They talk shit. You don't care.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
They play, oh, local guy,
yeah,
bad
yeah,
guy.
Yeah,
this girl didn't have the emotional strength or maturity or whatever. So when she sees her face on TV as like the January 6th anniversary, where are they now?
Yeah, yeah.
The Capitol insurrectionists. And she's like a 21-year-old farm girl.
Yeah.
So she, I mean, wasn't really her nature, I think, to be drunk. Anyway, so now it's her life. She pled to a nothing charge, nothing. But because of all the attention and the focus on her and the way her neighbors treated her, the way they whispered about her in the country club, she's got...
You got DUI manslaughter.
Well, they haven't charged her yet because they haven't gotten the toxicology reports back. And I was with her on Monday, and she said, "I don't even remember any of it." She herself got like blacked out. She was blacked out the whole time. Doesn't remember any of it.
So who did she kill? Or
the mother? She killed an
unknown person.
Oh, unknown.
She rode against traffic for 6 miles.
6 miles at 60 miles an hour.
And
she doesn't remember any of it.
She got into a car, and the woman who was sitting next to her husband, who drove, husband in the hospital, wife died.
I heard about it.
No, but that's an example of like if you go deep, if you're really a deep, it's like that's an example of like the kind of damage bad media. You can say like, oh, the media doesn't treat me fairly and they're full of shit. That's fine.
Right.
But like it's not ruining your life. This has ruined her life.
Mm-hmm.
And January 6th was like a blip.
Oh,
but
no,
the attention from it freaked her.
But because it takes a lot of time too.
No, but I don't mean just the words itself, but when you have people. I have people calling from Oregon that have nothing to do with my business, leaving bad reviews on my website, saying, "Oh, insurrectionist." Or I had my secretary that's scared of going to work because she's saying,
"Wait, hold on, Zani, that's not a bad thing to have. Like, it ruined my life." Or
well, you got the powder too. You got
I got
the
powder. I had.
It made it look like an anthrax. I think Andrew had to call out the cops. The chemical.
Why do people? Why it can be? People are so weird.
And it tested positive. The first test, and they said that somebody who knows what they're doing made sure that the first test, it'll test positive, like a field test, it'll pass that until they do the actual chemical. Like, it was very premeditated, and it had, like, a letter, like, to, oh, Proud Boy.
I had to get washed down, hazmat suit.
It referenced your thing's beeping too loudly now. How do you like this?
I opened the letter. I went to work. My secretary, I thought it was a bill or something, and when I opened my letter, I just went like that. White powder came out. I was thinking already, all right, anthrax or something like that. Who knows? Crazy people.
And the FBI shows up, and they were more like, it's almost like they were more interested in just searching his office. And then we were like, we didn't even trust them because they were like using it like, oh, who is he? And then we had to get the postal inspector out there to try and like, it was like a jurisdictional thing.
Yeah.
It was a mess. Total mess.
Yeah, my employees, I have about 20 employees. They're worried too.
Look, you're such an upstanding member of society.
Yeah.
Do they talk about that in the court?
No, of course not.
That's interesting.
Yeah, and like I said, I've never done nothing wrong.
At the trial, they will.
At the trial.
Yeah, status hearings is very...
Yeah, but they're gonna call, they're probably going to call me a white supremacist. As a matter of fact, I want it in Spanish. That was my first language, so...
That would be fine.
I want an interpreter for my next question.
Okay, so I want you to know that I'm from New York City, and I am was always, a long time ago, friends with Gavin McGinnis, who's supposedly the guy that started the Red Boys.
Right. Yes.
And he, when you say it was a drinking club, I'm just telling you guys, I don't know what the Proud Boys is, but I know Gavin McGinnis. I went on road trips with him to parties. Mm-hmm. It was so comical to me when I first started hearing about, like, Proud Boys are supreme. This was, like, years ago when they started saying in Brooklyn, where he's from. I was like, what? This guy, I mean, he may say, he may talk shit, but a lot of it is like, he's a provocateur. He says it to, like, be funny or whatever. But the idea that he's now being elevated to being this, it totally makes me laugh. Because I'm like, look, I know this guy. I've been to many parties with him. And I know he just says some crazy shit.
Yeah, about, like, the spiritual guru.
And he's supposed to be, like, the godfather. And I know that. So when they say Proud Boy, I'm always like, what is a Proud Boy? So that's why it's funny to me. It's
like I said, we'll sit around the table or call each other. Hey, where do you want to meet up? Can you figure out where to go eat? And it's like...
No, I mean, I know the Brooklyn version of those guys. And I'm just like... So I just wanted you to know that. Like, I have a whole history with these people, and I'm like, come on, you and your... Like, that's just kind of like... Anyway. Okay, well, I know that you have a job and a life and places to go. You don't have to worry. I'm not going to fuck you. I'm not going to do whatever you think it is about editing to the picture, good or bad. Yeah. No, I promise I won't.
Do you mind if I get a picture with you? No, I promise.
I wish I had...
I'm not going to do nothing bad. I'm not going
to... You can put a...